present some of the work that we are doing on propulsion systems for CubeSats and the development status for the Pocket Rocket Electrothermal Thruster. So this is at the Australian National University, and we have a research collaborator, which is at Stanford University. So of course now everyone is trying to develop thrusters or thruster systems for nanosatellites and all the issues around that. So I have a quick review now. So the standard thrusters, such as chemical thrusters, ion-graded thrusters, Hall-effect thrusters, they are mature technologies, they work quite well, they are trying to be miniaturized, usually they lose performance. They are still very expensive, very fiddly, but the development is happening. I'll just show one example, which is the Astrium hydrogen system. And for example, hydrogen is something you certainly don't want to use, or you can't actually use it in Australia. So you have the classic cold gas thruster. You just chuck up cold gas into space, and you expand it that way, and you'll get some thrust. And you can get one from Moog, and it's so expensive that you just look at it once and you say, okay, forget about that. We're going to develop low-cost technology here. There are quite a few contenders in terms of arc jets, and they work quite well. They usually sputter via an arc, sputter a target, and usually it's metallic being sputtered, and it's okay if your lifetime, your satellite is short. So they're quite good. And you have the resistor jets where you try to heat the propellant by heating up the walls of your thruster, and sometimes you have a chemical reaction as well. They work quite well as well. And you have a few kind of experimental ones, the holocathode thruster, the pulse plasma thrusters. These have been flown at least once by the UK. You don't really see the results. We don't really know if it's working, how it's working. And you have another type, which is the electrospray thruster, developed by MIT, flown by MIT and NASA, and by BUSEC as well. And we want to concentrate on the pocket rocket radio frequency thruster, first because it's radio frequency, and first because I think it can become a low-cost technology for the future. And I will mention that there is also the small iron-graded thruster, which is really advertised a lot by BUSEC, and which we can talk about later. I'm always happy to use. Okay, just briefly, a lot of this is also developed by universities. An example of a very successful group is the George Washington University group of Professor Kreda, and they also publish as they go along, which is very nice. They managed to fly a small called microcathode arc jet thruster on a CubeSat, and they managed to detumble the CubeSat. So this is quite a nice achievement. It's published, you can get the data. It's very, very interesting. So for us, we have been working on three different types of thrusters. The first one is the Helicon WS thruster, or Australian plasma thruster, quite big, nominal power of 1 kilowatt. And this was sponsored by Airbus for a long time, and we made a lot of progress with that one. But we realized that when it's big, a little bit complicated, you can't get your first access to space. We also developed another one in collaboration with ESA, that was a dual-stage four-grid thruster. So our radio frequency plasma, a system of electrodes for extraction of the ions. That was quite successful, but also not flown, because always the funding stops when you're about ready to go. And now we decided lately that we would just focus our energy on making something small and simple, as simple as possible with radio frequency, and that's the electrothermal radio frequency plasma microthruster. This was funded by Lockheed Martin for a couple of years. So I would like to say that, in fact, we can miniaturize all of these technologies. So there's a mini helicon, and we have idea on the BB thruster, and today I will talk about the mini pocket rocket thruster. So when we worked on this, we had to do a lot of development in terms of infrastructure. This was a development of a direct thrust balance in collaboration with the Surrey Space Satellite in the UK, also sponsored by Airbus. Here you see the Helicon WS thruster firing. You have a laser sensor system to measure the thrust directly. We characterize the plasma. So we made a lot of technological progress with this, which is turning out to be really useful now. So we went from this small chamber to a slightly bigger chamber to a much bigger chamber, which is Wombat XL. And Wombat XL, in terms of its thermal vacuum capability, also has a what we call the thruster annulus, which can accommodate thrusters from up to 50 kilograms in weight, any type, and that would be quite all right. This is the last version of our thruster, and we had also made some work on miniaturizing the subsystems. So when we miniaturize subsystems, so we have the thruster, we had here an impedance matching network, and we started developing a radio frequency amplifier or generator. We made a lot of progress because we went from 20 kilos to maybe 1 or 2 kilos, but this was not good enough. And the big challenge is, how do you go from TRL 6 to 9 when there's no space agency, no strange space agency, no money, no support? Some support, but just not clearly not enough compared to what you have in other countries. So we think that the only solution is really nanosatellite technology. And thanks to our network collaborators in the UK, we actually got into the QB50 project via the iron neutral mass spectrometer payload. So you've heard about this this miniaturized payload, which is here. And you've heard enough today about the QB50, but that's how we came into the game. And now we are also part of the Inspire 2 team. But we contributed in different ways. So with the iron neutral mass spectrometer, seeing our expertise with plasmas, and in particular plasma wind tunnels, they immediately offered to bring their flight prototype to Canberra, to ANU, to do some calibration, ground-based calibration, which they could not do at the time in the UK. So here is a small experiment that we have in Canberra, where we essentially have a helicon thruster here. And we know with this helicon thruster, we can generate an iron beam, large area iron beam, at a velocity of typically 10 kilometers per second. So the idea is that in the lab, we would have a stationary INMS payload, and we would throw ions at a velocity of 10 kilometers per second, and we would do our calibration that way. This is similar to having the INMS on a CubeSat in orbit at about 8 kilometers per second and measuring thermal ions. So this way we managed to contribute to the project, and the UK was very happy with that, and everyone's happy, so we're happy too. And of course, because we had developed the Wombat XL facility, thanks to the Australian Space Research Program, which ran essentially between 2011 and 2013, we had the Wombat XL chamber ready. So it was perfect for testing the three QB50 Australian CubeSats. So we are very happy that this has happened. And I hope that you agree that now nanosatellites are really a disruptive technology. Now, if we can provide a low-cost propulsion unit, that will be doubly disruptive. So you also know that we built our ground station so that we can learn about that aspect as well. So we'll finish this talk by talking about the latest status on a pocket rocket radio frequency electrothermal microthruster. So it's really tiny. The plasma cavity is 1 millimeter in diameter, about 2 centimeters long, and the rest is just structure around it, mechanical structure, and we can miniaturize that. So you put propellant through it, you heat the propellant with collisions within the plasma, and so you have an electrothermal plasma thruster. So it works best with argon or xenon, but possibly argon, not so well with the molecular gases. In fact, what you want to do, you want to pulse the radio frequency into the plasma, and you want to pulse the gas to really use minimum propellant and minimum power. And if you do that, we have shown that you can get heating of the gas over a few microseconds. So it's a fast turn-on thruster. So for we decided to develop the propellant subsystem and the RF power subsystem because these are not available commercially. So here is an example of the cheap propellant subsystem, a CO2 canister which you use to pump up your bike tire when it's flat, a little manual valve, and you can see that there's a plasma coupled here. And then we added different components, regulator, pressure transducers. This is a prototype, and how do you put this in a CubeSat? Well, you have a few student projects, they're very happy, and you end up with something like this, which can be put at the bottom of your CubeSat. So miniaturizations on both components mean that today you can actually make a lot of progress really fast. So Pocket Rocket can run at a cold gas thruster, and we want to see how we can make it create a plasma when we want. And we also had support from Lockheed Martin to demonstrate that there is thrust generated by this thruster. We measured up to 2 mN using xenon, but you can do the same with argon. So, and this was published. So we try and publish the results, because it's very difficult to get actual data on other thrusters. So to finish, I'd like to show the latest improvement of the RF power subsystem. So this is in collaboration with the University of Stanford. And we plan to have an integrated power system within a CubeSat wall. So the first prototype was tested about 1 year ago. So this is, the first prototype was actually 5 grand, the actual active component. It's a class 5.2 or class 2 inverter, which is a switch which creates essentially your radio frequency power. And then you have a matching network to adapt to the impedance to the plasma. And you have a wireless board to command this. And this is the battery pack. And you can see that you can create the plasma this way. So we managed to put the whole thing into our baby wombat on campus. So battery is here, thruster here. And you can see how we can do the test in vacuum. We managed to get 10 shots, and we had a fantastic fireworks with the transistor exploding. But this was still a great success. 1 year later, this is where we're at. It's really beautiful. I should have brought the actual one of the, we call it the converter. So it's integrated in a wall. We have made much more progress. So it's 87% efficient, including the matching, the loss in the matching network. Here you can see this CubeSat wall. This is a test at atmospheric pressure. I'm running a mini pocket rocket version of the thruster here. And recently we put the lot into the wombat vacuum, and you have this inside vacuum. And when we run, it was absolutely brilliant because, as you can see, the board is here and there is no parasitic discharge, which means the power is really going into the plasma. So for this test, I was running about 2.4 watts, about 100 times on, off, on, 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 off, on, off. Took it out, tested it again, it's still working. So I think we have made a great progress. This weighs about 150 grams, and we can now integrate the thruster into the CubeSat structure as well, and integrate with the propellant subsystem. So all the proofs of concepts have been demonstrated. And today we know that we have a CubeSat in orbit. So the next challenge will be to try and have this integrated within the CubeSat. We hope to be able to show at the international, at the AIC conference in Adelaide, something which looks real. And hopefully we have tested it in Wombat. So this answer here, number 3, yes, no, when I was preparing the slides, so yeah, yes. We are in space, and we'll hopefully we'll get a communication with this spacecraft in a few weeks' time. And we're also looking very much forward to doing the physics associated with this data. So thank you very much for your attention. You would get typically, so the first versions of radio frequency thrusters were typically 1 mN for 100 watts. But now we think we can get of the order of 0.1 mN for a few watts, maybe 10, for 10, I'd say 10 watts, maybe less. The thing is not to waste the power along the way. So at the moment, ISP would, for this would be always quite low, about 100. However, what I would like to mention is that this kind of subsystem can be scaled up to 1 kW. And so it would be very straightforward for us to make another mini helicon thruster with some grids, and then you can have the specific
that we
want.
You mentioned that you got 87% efficiency?
Yeah, for this.
What's the 87% efficiency?
This is actually at the moment for the power into the board and power into the plasma.
Power in and power out.
Yeah. And so if we decide to put grids in our other thruster, we can get a specific impulse about 1,000. Essentially, the proofs of concepts are sorted out. Now it's a matter of money and development. Okay, we are running out of time, so next talk, you.